Next of the point which we discuss would be about the osteoporosis, osteomalacia and related issues. Now, some clarification about these words, osteomalacia and osteoporosis. Osteomalacia is really a sort of rickets-like pathology in adults. In adults, because there is an abnormality of the calcium mineralization, the bones become weakened, and that kind of a pathology is called as osteomalacia. Whereas osteoporosis is a degenerative pathology where the bone strength is reduced, and because the bone strength is reduced, it will be susceptible for a fracture or injury. It's a weakening of the bone in the later period. So these two words, which are technically two different issues, but from the general clinical management point of view, they are not much of a significance different, because when you have a patient with the osteomalacia, the patient would also have some osteoporosis complications and vice versa. So more of academic issue than really the clinical issue. Radiologically, of course, osteoporosis and osteomalacia seem to be different, and from Ayurvedic management point of view, they do not make much of a difference. The difference is, in osteoporosis, the calcium content is lesser, the bone matrix is more, and whereas in osteoporosis, the calcium content will be lesser, bone matrix will be softened, and the whole bone tends to become somewhat brittle. Whereas in osteomalacia, there is lesser calcium content, matrix will become more prominent, bone becomes softer and hence tends to bend. That's the basic difference. The clinical differences are, again, I repeat the same issue, like osteomalacia is simply demineralization of the bone. Clinical symptoms are weakness of the muscles and fragile bones as such. Deformities tend to occur. There is supposed to be a vitamin D deficiency or hypophosphatemia. There could be other causes, could be aluminium toxicity also. And osteomalacia is adults, whereas a similar pathology in children is rickets. Whereas in osteoporosis, there is a reduced bone mineral density, and hence the assessment would be by the BMD studies, bone mineral density studies. There is increased risk of fractures. The bones may be curved or even particularly weight-bearing bones, often seen in old age. A possible calcium deficiency. Now, whether it's really a deficiency of the calcium or whether it's an abnormality of metabolism of the calcium, that's the point. And it's well known, like, it's really the metabolism of the calcium. Calcium is not properly utilized. It is not really the deficiency of the calcium which is responsible. And other causes for osteoporosis could be secondary to endocrine disorders, drugs, alcohol, lifestyle factors, or that could be occasionally an inherited pathology. The radiological evidences of the osteomalacia are very classical, where the epiphyseal ends of the bones, they tend to become widened, and you can see a gap-like, line-like structures, sun-like spicule-like, sunray spicule-like appearances over the epiphyseal ends of the bones. And often weight-bearing joints like the hip joint or the vertebral bodies, they are more commonly involved than really less weight-bearing joints, but less weight-bearing joints like wrists also could be involved. Then there is a tendency for the bones to be bent also. So osteomalacia is diagnosed radiologically with that typical sign of with epiphyseal changes. Whereas the osteoporosis is about the study of the bone mineral density, which has to be done. The bone mineral density, of course, in the osteomalacia also, the bone mineral density is to be studied. Now, bone mineral density now again has become a fashion now. I think lots of people are aware of that issue, and many of the patients would have that bone mineral density test free of cost, but the prescription would be with the cost as such. Most of the prescription would be the calcium. About the bone mineral density, brief about that. It's about study of the ratio between the lamellar bone and the medullary bone, and comparing that density of the bone calcium in relation to the age. There are two scores given, the T-score as well as a Z-score. T-score is the patient's bone density in compared to the control subjects who are at their peak BMD. Like their peak BMD will be the young age, age of 20 to 30, that the BMD will be peak as such. In the young, before 20, the BMD is usually lesser. after 30, there is a tendency for gradual reduction of the BMD. The range of BMDT scores would be somewhat of the average, and that is a, there is a comparison of these two, this average in the T-score. Z-score is a density compared to with the patients matched with for age and sex as such. So, T is about the peak, possible peak in that patient and comparison to that. Z is about the general population of that particular age and sex. So, you will get the T and the Z-scores. Usually what happens is when a patient of above 40 goes to for this BMD test, essentially the T-score will be always showing a negative trend, and once you see the negative trend, of course the patients will be always worried about that what the results are seen, either the results are presented in bold letters or underlined or maybe in the red fonts, and then the patients, of course Google Pandit patients will be really testing the doctor, and that calcium supplement has is a very common phenomenon. Now, that's one of the problems which we face usually in the regular clinical practice. To convince the patient like this, make the patient understand about the significance of these tests is quite difficult. Now, the normal range is what you get is a T-score of anything like less than 1 is or minus 1 is considered as a, within that normal limits. Whereas, when it's less than minus 1 to or minus 2 to 3, it's considered as a bone mass, reduced bone mass or osteopenia. There is another word, osteopenia. These words do not have much of a significance except for maybe confusing the poor patients often. Then the osteoporosis, established osteoporosis is when the T-score is markedly lesser than 2.3. And a severe established osteoporosis is when the T-score is minus 2.5, and at that stage the patient will have osteoporosis. This is a real basic assessment. And as I said, when the patients of above 40 or 50 goes for the BMD study, essentially T-score will be in the minus side, and usually they come under the stage of minus 2.3, and often the patients are over-prescribed. That's the issue. Now, the osteoporosis, again, could be of different types. It's not always like the old age being the cause for the osteoporosis. There could be juvenile osteoporosis when it occurs in young children. There could be some abnormality related to the genetic factors, or there could be other systemic functions, systemic abnormalities also, like would be the pain in the bones and fractures occurring as such. Then of course, as usual, you will have a group called as idiopathic osteoporosis. But from the clinical point of view, the majority of the patients whom we see in that category are the postmenopausal osteoporosis, very common, and it's also called as a type 1. Very commonly, it occurs in women in the age of around 50 or beyond that, and characterized by a typical accelerated bone loss. Fractures, they tend to occur, that's the typical feature of the osteoporosis which occurs in the old age. Then in the senile, above the age of 70 or plus 70 plus, even it occurs in the men, and BMD is reduced by markedly. So that's the typical presentation of osteoporosis, and osteoporosis, the typical clinical presentation is most of the times asymptomatic. The patient would not have any symptoms except that gradually there is a bending or changing in the shape of the bone. Very often is a kyphosis where the patients tend to bend forwards. In low trauma fractures, they are more susceptible to fractures, and even a minimal trauma, they tend to produce the fracture. There could be a reduction in the height. Back pain, of course, is one of the very common clinical symptoms in case of osteoporosis. Back pain is one of the troublesome clinical conditions. When a large number of diseases can present with the back pain, clinical assessment of the back pain and making the diagnosis is often a real major issue for the clinician. Of course, that's a point which we'll just keep it as such. In typical, when the patient presents as back pain in osteoporosis, the typical presentation would be, there will be an episode of acute pain which may follow either a minor fall or minor trauma. There is no classical signs of the fracture. Pain is often localized to specific vertebral level. Often it's in the higher level, mid thoracic or maybe the lower thoracic or upper lumbar spine. Rarely it involves the lower lumbar spine. So usually it's in the thoracic 10th to L2. These are the segments which are often involved. When I say this, I am not saying that the lower L4, L5 are not involved. That's not true. But rare, they are rare. Whereas the other way, osteoarthritis-like conditions, it is the lower back ache which is involved. So a clinical differentiation, this is one of the clue which helps to differentiate between an osteoporosis and a typical osteoarthritis or disc pathologies, endovertebral disc pathologies. The endovertebral disc pathologies, they are more prone to occur in the lower vertebral bodies. Anyway, we'll come to that point also later. The pain is usually described as a sharp pain or dull pain many times. Movement will increase the pain in some cases. Pain radiates to the abdomen than really to the lower limbs. That's because the upper vertebral bodies are more frequently involved. Pain is accompanied by the muscle spasm, which is increased by the activity and decreased by lying spine. This also is one of the differences between a intervertebral disc pathology and the osteoporosis. Osteoporosis patients would be more comfortable in a supine position, whereas intervertebral disc pathology patients, they would find it difficult to lie supine. They tend to lie in a curved position as such. Patients remain motionless on the bed because of fear of exacerbating the pain, so they tend to lie down constantly in the same position. Usually, the acute pain reduces spontaneously within 4 to 6 weeks. And later, gradually, it develops in kyphosis. This is how the patients will be presented when osteoporosis produces a back pain. Now, I just refer to the back pain because that is the most common presentation of the osteoporosis in the clinical conditions. Osteoporosis can involve the other bones too, and in that condition, the clinical presentation would be almost a similar nature, but the presentation will be depending upon the anatomical location of the bone involved. Incidence of the osteoporosis is supposed to be quite high and it's increasing. Year by year, the incidence is increasing. Causes, of course, there are many causes suspected. The very popularly accepted cause is the globalized lifestyle. It is about the diet as well as the exercise. Lack of exercise and so-called rich diet. These are the causes of the osteoporosis. Now, comparison of osteoporosis, the burden of osteoporosis compared to other disease conditions. Incidence of osteoporosis globally is very high, though it's not a life-threatening condition, but it's one of the debilitating condition. And hence, osteoporosis is now considered as one of the major interests of the health policies. The other disease comparatively would be lesser heart attacks and strokes. And breast cancer in the older age group. Now, common disease incidence comparison, this is just a vague comparison of the incidence pathology showing you the highlight importance of the osteoporosis. In our practice setup point of view, majority of the patients of osteoporosis would end up in Ayurvedic clinic, and popularly the patients also in the society also, there is a belief that the osteoporosis like bone conditions, they are better treated with the Ayurvedic treatment, and hence they often tend to come over to assess. To assess the osteoporosis, there is a self-assessment tool which is very popular, and this self-assessment tool is in relation to the weight, because body weight is considered to be one of the major risk factors for the osteoporosis, and a easy method of a self-assessment for the possibility of osteoporosis is in relation to the body weight. A weight of 60 to 64, and when the patient's body weight is above 54 as such, the risk increases. As the weight increases, the risk increases as such, and as the age increases also, the risk increases. So those patients who come under this category, that gray category, they have a high risk. Those who come under the green category would have a lesser risk. So higher the age and the weight, these are the two important factors. By this, you can predict about the risk of the patient's asset. It's also true that the incidence is more in the females than in the males. So in the women, incidence is more of osteoporosis than really the males. These are the results of the study which are known. Now anyway, that's about the osteoporosis and osteomalacia together. we will not make out the difference from Ayurvedic point of view. From our point of view, I would consider the Asthi Majjhakshaya and Asthi and Majjhakshaya rather as the possible Malaysia as well as osteoporosis. The clinical features which are described are Shijante Ivatastini, Durbalani, Lagunita, Ratatam Vatarogini, Kshine Majjan Dehinam, the Asthi Sandhi Shaitilya, there will be fragility of the joints. And the bones tend to become fractured, tend to have a tendency for the fracture. They tend to become weak and softer, lighter. And because I consider this as a Dhatu Kshayajanya Vyadhi, my prescription would be Chandraprabha Gokshiradhika Kulu Rasnadhikvata. Chandraprabha being Rasayana Dravya, and I prescribe that regularly as a Rasayana Dravya. We have recorded that issue in the beginning also about the questions last week. And about the prescription of the drugs and the logic rationality behind the prescription of the drugs, we have discussed in an earlier session of CME in the beginning, where I have referred to the rationality of my prescriptions, the drugs which I prescribe. I think we need not repeat about that part as such. That's what I prescribe as such. Rasna being Sandhanaka Dravya and one of the suggested treatment in case of the Asthivah Srotas like condition. Radhyapanabhasti is also prescribed in a large number of patients, which will be definitely beneficial. I don't say that osteomalacia or osteoporosis can be reversed and cured completely. There is no question of that cure, but complications can be definitely avoided and patient can have a better living as such. So that's about the osteoporosis and osteomalacia related to the bone growth and the mineralization factors. Next up, the disease which we consider would be arthritis, very commonly used condition like the joint pathology. Among the arthritis, patients presenting with the joint pain, the causes could be many, and among those different causes, the commonest is osteoarthritis. So we will discuss that osteoarthritis with a somewhat more importance. Next up, the conditions would be of significance are rheumatism in general, soft tissue rheumatism. Soft tissue rheumatism is a vague pathology which we will discuss maybe in due course of time. Today we will not go much into that topic. Rheumatoid arthritis is another of the condition which is of some significance, which we will try to refer to. Then there are some miscellaneous conditions of different sites. This is about the general epidemiology of the arthritis conditions. Almost every fourth patient whom you see with the joint pain would be of osteoarthritis in the clinical factors. Now, osteoarthritis, whether it has to be named as osteoarthritis or arthrosis, is another of the issue. Again, we will not go into that debate as such, because arthritis suggests about inflammation, arthrosis suggests about the wear and tear. Now, whether it is really an inflammation or whether it is a real wear and tear, these questions always remain. We will not go into that part. But in general, majority of the people would accept that it is a wear and tear pathology, and often related to the age and lifestyle factors like obesity, strain, these are considered as the causes. Now, strain, overstraining is a cause for osteoarthritis. At the same time, lack of exercise also is a cause for the osteoarthritis. This fact has to be kept in mind. Then osteoarthritis also is a later consequence of any other joint pathology. It can be a secondary to other disease conditions. Rheumatoid arthritis, gouts, infective disorders, trauma also can result in osteoarthritis as such. These are considered the secondary osteoarthritis. Often osteoarthritis is presented in the major joints more commonly than in the minor joints. And when it occurs in the major joints like the knee joint, and knee joint is the most commonly involved joint there, the typical presentation will be deep pain in the joints, and patient can make out that difference of the deep pain compared to the superficial pain. And usually it's related to the use, like when the patient does some exercise in the beginning, it's always related to some amount of the exercise. Only when patient goes to walks a certain distance, the patient would develop the pain. If till within that range, the pain would not be there. That's the initial clinical symptom. But gradually, as the condition progresses, that ability of the patient to do the exercise will be gradually reduced, and then the patient may even have pain during the rest. So it's not really the pain during the rest, rather it's a stiffness which is felt in the rest conditions. As the patient gets up from the resting condition, initially a few steps would be difficult to walk, but once the patient is able to walk, then the pain would be somewhat lesser. Many a times the patient will also have more pain at night, rather at night, early morning, as the patient gets up. The reason is simple, because in the active state, in the daytime, the muscles bear the weight upon the joints, share the weight of the joints to a great extent, and hence the joints are protected and the muscles are in a tonic condition. When you sleep and when the muscles are relaxed, this extra sharing of the load is not there, and hence the bones are under more stress. Hence the pain will be more in the early morning hours. This early morning hours pain has to be differentiated from the stiffness of the rheumatoid arthritis, where the stiffness would last for a long time, like at least 1 hour. Whereas the stiffness produced due to osteoarthritis would be for a few steps. Once the patient starts moving the joint, within a short period, usually less than 30 minutes, the stiffness will be reduced and the patient will be somewhat comfortable. That's the typical differentiation, and these are an important part in the clinical examination of the patients with the joint pain to help you to differentiate the different causes. Range of movement tends to be reduced in case of osteoarthritis, either moderately or severely, depending upon the situation when the patient has come to you. Or in very severe conditions, there could be even crepitus, that abnormal sounds. Shape of the joint tends to become altered due to the osteophytes, a new growth of the bone would occur, and this is also named technically as yelling, because it tends to have L shape as such, and hence it's often named as yelling. Whereas in minor joints, comparatively lesser, and often minor joints are produced due to lifestyle factors, overstraining of the particular joint, like the joints, interphalangeal joints or wrist joints are involved in due to repetitive uses, like keyboard uses or any occupational factors where you use the same joint repeatedly. And often when it occurs in the distal interphalangeal joints, that's the distal phalangeal joints are often involved more commonly in such conditions. Proximal interphalangeal joints or carpometacarpal joints are the base of the thumb also are typically involved in those conditions where the persons would have some occupation factors. So if you take the history about the type of the occupation, you can make out whether it's really osteoarthritis or the other way. Usually, when a patient presents with pain in the minor joints, we will be suspecting the rheumatism than really the osteoarthritis, but osteoarthritis of the minor joints also are possible as primary conditions also. Then, of course, patients who have a rheumatoid pathology, at one stage they will have the same consequence of the osteoarthritis. That's also true. Then, abundance nodules, like because of the hardening of this osteophyte developing, the bones become hardened and there will be the swelling across the joint area, and that they are called as abundance nodules, and they are palpable hard bone-like structures. Joint shape may be altered, and often they are more common in women than really the men. Then inflammatory changes are usually absent. The local tenderness will be comparatively lesser in case of the osteoarthritis. Radiological grading of the osteoarthritis is done with, there are lots of methods of grading. If you go into the text, you will have lots of methods of grading. But the more popular is Kale grading or Kullgren-Lorenz grading. And the grading is based upon, particularly with the knee joint, the joint space reduction. In the initial stage, grade 1, it's considered as radiologically normal, where there will be no identifiable abnormality in the x-rays. So, you'll have plenty of such patients where the x-rays are normal, but the patient will have complaints of the pain. As the condition progresses, there will be a gradual minor osteophytic changes, and the level of this joint space tends to be reduced. There is a gradual tendency for the joint space to be reduced. Either it could be initially on one side, maybe medial or lateral, then gradually it tends to increase as such. The joint space is markedly reduced, then it's considered grade 4, whereas it's minutely reduced, it's grade 3. This is how radiological grading is done based upon the features of the joint space. There is also a international knee documentation committee, particularly with the knee joint osteoarthritis. There again is the same issue, but the grading pattern is somewhat different with an objective measurement of the joint, like joint space is measured in the X-rays, and when it is 4 mm joint space, and then there are very small osteophytes, that's considered as a moderate. Then the joint space is not altered, but only the pain is symptom is considered as A grade. The B grade is when it's at least 4 minor joint spaces are 4 millimeter joint space is reduced. It's present at least 4 millimeter, and when the space has reduced to 2 to 4 millimeters, less than 4 and towards the 2 as such, then it's considered as C or third grade. Then when it is less than 2 millimeters, it's considered as D or fourth grade. That's the another method of classification. Of course, there are lots of other basic issues. The only difference is about the issue of a objective assessment of the joint space. In the ANDLOC, it's the 5 mm is considered as the critical level, and less than 5 mm or the difference is rather when it is more significant, then it is considered as of greater degrees. I think we will not go into that issue. Primarily, basic issue will be about the joint space and assessing the motility. Radiological changes produced due to osteoarthritis also are of different degrees. It could be like the joint space seen being reduced either unilaterally, or maybe the joint space being reduced along with the displacement of the bone, as you see in the second X-ray, the hip bone could be suggestive of that mild displacement, migration of the femoral head to the superior side. And narrowing of the joint with a osteophyte, the typical osteophytes are seen with even occasionally cyst-like formation, subchondral cyst-like formation due to the degenerated bone, or a subchondral sclerosis, that cyst may become sclerosed and hardened. So some sort of degeneration, then there is a hardening of the bone. So changes may occur with that deformities also. When these changes occur, there could be visible deformities of the hands also. Then it could be like the space being reduced. Some of the examples like a marked sclerosis and the space is reduced, as in case of the patellofemoral compartment where there is a marked narrowing and the osteophytes are developed. And this position of the patella is raised up, producing a bump, a swelling which is seen, I will refer to that issue, close to cachexia, where there will be visible significant abnormality due to that displaced patella as such, or of course the osteophytes affecting the carpofemoral or metacarpal joints as such. Now, management of osteoarthritis, the universal, the popular guidelines are the NICE guidelines. NICE guidelines, the chart is like this. For the clarity, I have just presented the same guideline in two slides so that you will be able to see what the details are. A management of the osteoarthritis is considered to be like, because it is a degenerative pathology, often it is believed that it is an irreversible pathology, and hence the approach should be a holistic approach. Scope for the medical or pharmacological intervention is comparatively lesser. Rather, majority of the patients can be managed with certain other alternative methods. And before you suggest any of these methods, there are multiple factors which need to be considered, like the lifestyle, occupational requirement of the patient, the activity required by the patient in the particular job, his social conditions. These are to be considered before we suggest any sort of the treatment. Or the, of course, patient's belief about the health conditions also are to be respected. As I said, majority of the patients of osteoarthritis, they say that Ayurvedic treatment would be more beneficial than the other conditions, and I usually consider these diseases as the bread and butter of Ayurvedic practitioners. Then the mood of the patient, like whether the patient is, most of the patients with osteoarthritis, because of the chronicity of the conditions, they will have abnormality of the mood, they need some psychological support, and many times they need some antidepressant drugs also often, and they tend to have a disturbance of the sleep. The quality of the sleep also is one of the issues, because many times the patient would have that pain troubling the disturbance, this sleep as such. Then the family conditions, like whether somebody else is there to help the patient or not. This also is a criteria to decide about the mode of the treatment. Then whether the patient has any other muscular skeletal conditions. It could be like, along with the osteoarthritis, the patient may often have other pathologies which can produce the complications, either related to the pain, or it also could be other comorbidities like diabetes. Most of the times diabetes, hypertension and so on, those other complications which could occur, they also have to be considered. And the patient's attitude to the exercise, whether the patient is ready to do the exercise or not, these are all to be considered. And then the planning has to be managed. Like, majority of the patients can be managed without a medication. Pain assessment and pain management with the medication is to be considered as a last resort when the others do not help. This is what the NICE guidelines would say. The clinical options for the OA treatment which are available in the contemporary system of medicine are, I think as I said, is lifestyle modification, primarily weight loss and diet. So it's often believed that the patient's body weight is always related to osteoarthritis, and the reduction of the weight is considered to be one of the options. Traditional pharmacotherapy is NSAIDs, then complementary medicines, naturopathic pharmacotherapy, etc. Vitamin supplement, antioxidants, these are also are regularly prescribed. How far they are beneficial is question mark. Again, we will not go into that issue. We will be discussing our treatment only, but at the same time we should know about the contemporary situation even. Then the braces and kneecaps supports given over the area, they are really beneficial in such conditions, but whether these are accepted to the patient or not is the other issue. Physical therapy like exercise, physiotherapy is also one of the options. Then the physical modalities like fermentations, diathermy, etc. Fermentations, diathermy and local applications of liniments, which are rather counter-irritant substances, they can give some relief to the patient, but this relief is a false relief. It's not really relieving the pathology, reversing the pathology, and this false relief of pain often can hasten the disease process, accelerate the disease process. So, but still, in selective patients, in some patients where you can guide about the restriction of the physical exercise after that pain relief, it can be useful. But if you do not do that, because the patient has a false sense of relief and hence he does the over exercise, the pathology can be enhanced rather hastened, and hence rather it's the other way. Pain protects the patient from further damage. So artificial relief of the pain with that kind of fermentation or local counter irritants, or maybe the local pain reducing drugs, can be harmful to the patient. Then there is another manipulation therapy like local compression, massage, etc. Again questionable. Massage, these are not really going to helpful, because a massage there can increase the rate of osteophyte formation. But still in some patients it can be helpful. So I am not just saying that it should not be, universally should not be used, like selectively it could be used. Then you have the options of interventional therapy like intra-articular injections or surgical treatment where arthroscopy, decompression, etc. are the other options in the treatment. From Ayurvedic point of view, I consider these pathology of the osteoarthritis either as Astigata Vata or Gudagata Vata or Pittavata Vata, depending upon the causes. When it is a metabolic pathology, it's really the Astigata Vata, where the clinical features would be Bedaha Astiparvanam Sandhishulam Mamsa Balakshayaha Aswapnaha Santadarupcha. These are due to the involvement of Vata, and there is a primary pathology with the metabolism, maybe the Agni as such, and hence our treatment would be towards the Agni and then Vata Vyati. Then secondary to other disorders, Vajjanga Urutrika Prishta Roga Shosho Gudasthite, Gudagata Vata also would be presented with the often the pain, and this is often due to secondary to other disorders because of the Gudagata Vata, where there would be some other abnormality of Hrnabi Pashodara Ruku Trishna Udgara Vishutika. Gastrointestinal tract symptoms also are often presented, will happen, and often rather it's loose stools or maybe the constipation which is often presented in such patients. Or in Pittavata Vyana is often due to the lifestyle factors like consumption of excess of spicy food, and where the patient would have a generalized pain, sasantapaha savedana, bhuta sarvagata, obesity would also be presented over the area, and daha sarvangaragaha, a generalized symptom, may not be limited only to the weight-bearing joints, the patient may have generalized symptoms. These are the often three categories of the patients whom we see. In addition to that, the description of a Kostuka Shirsha, where the joint abnormality would be so conspicuous, like that of a head of a fox, and hence you will be able to see a box-like projection, the patellar displacement and the patellar prominence seen as case of a fourth degree osteoarthritis condition. Now coming to the management point of view, Sushil has clearly described Gugulu as one of the most preferable prescription in case of Vata Vyadi. Results are due to the guna of Vata Gugulu, Sugandhi Sulabhu, and the ultimately what Sushil has said is Kosta Sanjastigam Vayum Vriksham Indrashinhi Yata in the Sanjastigata Vata and Kostagata Vata. It's most efficient and it could be destroying the pathology like a lightning describing a tree. So considered to be very effective as such. And of course you will have plenty of Gugulu yogas which could be prescribed. Then the other options which are suggested are Bhakshyabhyantarada Snehana, the Snehana which has to be done. When I say the Snehana, I always mean to say either it could be the Snehapana or the Snehabhasti. Application of the taila over the surface, Abhyanga, may not be a optimum form of the Snehana, and I in my prescription never prescribe this application of any of these irritant substances. The so-called often liniments, almost every Ayurvedic pharmacy would have some specific drug which is used for that local application of the pain balm, relief, liniments and so on, with lots of different names over there. And even in the folklore practice also, we'll have many of such preparations. But each of these preparations would be having a counter-irritant substance, some volatile substance, and karpura or so on. And these counter-irritant substances may produce a false sense of relief to the pain, but they are not really sneha-priyas. They are mostly tikshna-priyas. A real snehana would be when you use either a sneha-basti or sneha-pana. So sneha is the option of the treatment. Along with that, Sushruta also has suggested, Vaghbhata has suggested bandhana also, that's maybe a support, maybe the kneecap and so on, so available supplements. Now when I prescribe the drugs, my prescription will be based upon the clinical assessment, like when a patient presents with the Shura Pradhana, where the pain itself is the maximum, maybe in the early stages of osteoarthritis, where other deformities of either the shotha or the dhatukshaya, osteoporosis or the edema, the changes in the joint space are not conspicuous, my prescription would be Yogaraja Gugulu, Vishamasthuti or Mrityunjaya, depending upon the status of the patient. Mrityunjaya is when there is a Amalakshana, Vishamasthi is when there is a Niramalakshana. And of course, Yogaraja and Vishamasthuti, they are mainly targeted about the Shula Lakshana of the Vata Vyadi. And I usually prescribe Avipratikara Churna as an Anulomana Dravya. If possible, or wherever possibility is that, Matra or the Niruhabhasthi is prescribed. So Matrabhasthi is often prescribed in condition of acute pain. Niruhabhasthi is also prescribed if the patient has rigidity, more of rigidity than the other. Then in the Shotha Pradhana, where the patient would have more of a swelling, or maybe at times the effusion in the joint, joint space is altered, but osteophytes are not very conspicuous. My preference will be Gokshyabhyantarada Gugulu, Punarnamandura or Mrityunjaya. Again, Punarnamandura or Mrityunjaya are chosen depending upon the Amalakshanas. If the patient has Amalakshana, Mrityunjaya. If it is a Nirama, Punarnamandura. Majority of the patients of this category would have the Amalakshana. Amritarishta also is from the point of view of treating that Ama due to presenting with the Shotha. I consider this Shotha Pradhana condition as a Ama Janya Vyadhi as such, and preference would be Kshara-Vasthi. When the patient has a gross deformity, degenerative changes, crepitus and so on, that's a Dhatakshaya Janya Vyadhi, where main prescription will be Chandra Prabha, Balarishta, Ashwagandharishta. Kaishava Gugulu, of course, it's both Rakta Prasadaka as well as Astigata Prasadaka. So hence it is often prescribed as this is usually how I prescribe, and Radhayapanabhasthi is prescribed. More than the medical treatment, diet, exercise are essential. Exercise has to be prescribed. I always advise the patient to do regular physical exercises to the limit possible to that patient. Considering all the other issues like patient's other disease pathologies and maybe the other complications which the patient has. Absolutely no fermentations are counterintuitive in my prescriptions. I don't prescribe them as such. Now, a bit about certain controversies which are present in the osteoarthritis management, which we should be having some idea. Of course, every medical literature and there is a lot of medical literature about the advantages of exercise in osteoarthritis. But somehow, very popularly, majority of so-called specialist practitioners, they are advising the patient not to do the exercise. Exercises are being restricted as a management of the osteoarthritis. Now, this is a very controversial issue. Exercise restriction may be necessary only in those debilitated conditions where the person is not able to bear weight at all. Even in that condition, we may have to suggest an exercise which would be suitable for that particular status than really total restriction of the exercise. Bed rest or may severe restriction of the exercise would enhance the degeneration of the bone. And it is now proved very well that a moderate exercise will always be beneficial. So it's always advisable to have the patients to continue to do the exercise regularly. When we were studying in the olden days, we had studied that osteoarthritis is only a disease of the old age, and we would always make the diagnosis of osteoarthritis above the age of 60. But now the total demography of the disease has changed. Even in the patients of 20s, you may have the evidence of the osteoarthritis. Reason is simple. Because the people do not use the organs given by the nature, your legs are not used. Instead, for every activity, you need some vehicles. Even the hands also are less used. For everything, you have machines. So, mechanization of the life is one of the basic factors which increases the degeneration of the bones. So, we say a comfortable living, but that comfortable living is really harmful to the body. And of course, there are many people who do not do any their regular physical day-to-day activity, but they do lots of specialized exercises. This also is not really good. A person who does his day-to-day activities by himself, they would have a lesser chance of developing osteoarthritis. Our older generation grandfathers, they had lesser incidence of osteoarthritis because they used to do their work manually. And they used to do all sorts of rigorous activities, and hence the incidence of osteoarthritis was lesser, and osteoarthritis would be occurring only in the older age, above 60 or so on. But now, because the lifestyle has changed, and of course the diet also has changed, the incidence of osteoarthritis now has become even a disease of the younger age. So, that's the point. And these are all presented or studied, and lots of publications are there which support this issue. And another of the controversial issue is the use of Indian Kumud or Western Kumud. Now, a general advice to the patients of osteoarthritis is to avoid Indian Kumud and use the Western Kumud. I always advise the patients to use the Indian Kumud because using that Indian Kumud would give you an opportunity for the knee to be completely flexed, and hence possibility of the osteoarthritis can be reduced markedly. Of course, Western Kumud would be really beneficial if the patient has reached to that level where the squatting would be impossible. So, only in those conditions where the person is not able to squat at all, a Western Kumud could be as an alternative measure. But whenever it is possible, it is better to adopt that squatting position. Sitting on the floor, do some regular religious activities like Surya Namaskara and so on. Yoga therapies also would be very beneficial in the patients of osteoarthritis, and many times the drug medicinal management can be even reduced or avoided if these are taken care of. And but The general advice is usually given in and general belief in the society is the other way. So many times it could be difficult to convince the patient, but I would make it a point to convince the patient about these as advantages as such. Limitations of the local analgesics. Now, one of the very commonly used prescriptions in the patients, almost every patient who comes to the clinic would be using one or other sorts of the local analgesics. And as I repeatedly said, earlier also we have referred that issue, there is a significant limitation. It may produce a temporary relief, but temporary relief would be producing long-term complications in both the ways, as an adverse effect of the analgesic drug directly, or maybe the faster degeneration of the bone. These also are now well studied. I have just collected a few of the popular, very popular and authentic references about the articles published about the limitations of local analgesics. Those who are interested, they can go through these references. So it's not only me who is saying the other way. But practically, in the general prescription uses, use of analgesics has become very popular, and the incidence of these analgesic prescription is somewhat increasing. But only the difference is the choice of the drugs. In the initial days, in the olden days, it was the diclofenac which was was more popularly used, whereas in the present days, you have the naproxen and its derivatives, or ropicoxib, which are the later, newer drugs which are prescribed more commonly. So again, I am not going to comment about that part. But when a patient is using those analgesics and when he comes for IV treatment, I would always ensure that the patient stops those analgesics. Stopping those analgesics initially can make the patient feel worse. It's quite natural that our medicines would not have the same efficacy of a pain reduction as that of the analgesics. Hence, it will be difficult to convince the patients for a few days. But if the patient continues our treatment for at least 2 weeks or 1 month, then the patient, every patient can make out that difference between an analgesic treatment and the ayurvedic treatment. So that first 2 weeks or maybe 1 month could be the critical phase. Some of the patients may not accept this treatment because they are already accustomed to these analgesics, and they may not tolerate that somewhat aggravation of the pain in the initial days. They may drop out. But that dropout percentage would not be very significant, and hence in my practice, I always ensure that the patient doesn't continue analgesics, any sort of analgesics, with our treatment as such. So that's one of the points. Recent days, another of the common prescription which is prescribed is glucosamine, and at one stage glucosamine was considered to be a panacea for the osteoarthritis. It is considered to be one of the drugs which will produce the regeneration of the bone, and osteoarthritis was believed to be a disease which could be cured. But gradually, the tendency for prescription of the glucosamine in the Western countries, it had increased up to 2009. Now that has flattened, and there is a gradual tendency to reduce. But in India, the situation is totally different. The incidence of, there is no such official graph, but suppose if I have to draw the graph of the possible prescription in India, though we do not have a obvious data, but my idea is it's now almost in nearing the vertical. The tendency for prescription of the glucosamine is increasing very rapidly, and in the present days prescriptions is one of the very frequently prescribed drugs. Whereas in the Western countries, the market for glucosamine is reducing, and in the Eastern countries it is increasing. Again, I will not go beyond that, because it's not my job to criticize, but we have to be aware of that. Now, another gradual change in the trend of the treatment now is the surgical treatment. Incidence of the total knee replacement throughout the globe is increasing rapidly, and it is supposed to be it may reach about 60,000 per million population by 2030. So incidence of knee replacement surgery could be rapidly increasing, and it is increasing throughout the globe. Of course, this is what's predicted, like, and at present we are at this level, something like around 40,000 per million population globally. The trend is changing also in India, and the market is supposed to be very high throughout the globe, and it's one of the money spinning activity in the future. In India also, the knee replacement now has become popular. I think recently the present government has subsidized the rates of that knee replacement instrument, and hence the cost of the instrument has reduced in the last 3 years back, I think in 2016 or 15. This was done. The cost was reduced by around 65% of all that different varieties of the instruments, and after that there is a surge of increase in the surgical practices, and knee replacement surgeries are becoming more popular. Now, whether the patient would prefer a surgery or a medical treatment is not the question. If a patient prefers a surgical treatment, I would not prevent that patient from going for surgery. After all, with the surgery, there can be a relief of the pain. With the total replacements, mobility also would be somewhat better. Whereas in the earlier conditions, like a partial replacement or orthodontic surgery was the standard, then the mobility would have been drastically reduced. But large number of the patients still prefer a medical treatment over the surgical treatment. Indications for the surgical treatment also be only in the fourth degree, not in the earlier stages. But somehow now there is a practice of prescribing surgery even in the earlier stages. These are all the issues. So when a patient comes to you and asks the question like whether should we go for the surgery or not, we should be aware of the present day situation, trends and so on, and our opinion should be along with that line as such. Then there is another new concept coming up, like a medical food, which is a new concept, and flavococcid is one of that medical food which is prescribed in the management of the osteoarthritis, and this is the recent trend coming in, but not yet very popular. But in a few years in India, you will have a flood of this flavococcid prescription. I don't know how far it will be useful. That's about rheumatoid arthritis in brief.